thank all of you for being here, for giving me such a nice welcome. I'd like to thank General Rapp and the school for having me here today. Having done this last year, I was afraid they wouldn't invite me back, but lo and behold, they did. Now, you may notice that General Rapp isn't here. That's not an accident. He and I had a little discussion before I came out. I was horrified to learn that of all people, who was going to upstage me by talking to you this morning? Dave Perkins. How would you like to follow Dave Perkins? I mean, he should just have, General Rapp should have just sent you all home to contemplate these words for the rest of the afternoon. But instead, you have me. Now, my plan was to sit here, stand here at the podium, subtly looking at my notes as I went through my prepared remarks before we get into the questions and answers, which I think, as usual, is the most productive part of any discussion. But having watched Perkins' performance, these notes are history, gentlemen and ladies. I'm going to be out here pretending to be him. Actually, I do have a little cheat sheet. Because next week I'm going to be 70, and good grief, what's General Perkins, 33? Okay, to shift the theme a little bit, because it is a serious theme, and one of my goals here today is to try to build a little bit on the program that you're all completing this month, this week. It's a very, very serious program. You've devoted your lives in various ways to it, as have I. I'll focus on national security policy, particularly formulation, particularly the problems in formulation, and a lot on civilian-military relations, because that seems to be woven into the problematic. Let me start with a quote, and I'll use General Flynn, and I'm not trying to bring politics into this, but he said something a week ago that caught my attention and probably many of yours. He said, "America has forgotten how to win." Now, as we heard this morning from General Perkins, we can define winning in different ways. Winning a fight, winning a conflict, winning a geostrategic endeavor. But it's still something, it's food for thought, particularly for the Army. By my count, because I split Korea into two campaigns, the North Korean liberation and the defense of South Korea, we've deployed some roughly 100 to 500,000 ground combat, our troops totally, in six conflicts since 1945. North Korean campaign, the South Korean campaign, Vietnam, Afghanistan, Iraq, and the first Gulf War. How many of you think we won all six? Five. Four? Ah, oh, we got one five, okay. How many four? Three. Less than three, show of hands. Okay, thank you. The good news is that isn't all we've done in foreign policy or even military affairs since 1945. Just in the Middle East, I recently did a publication for the Washington Institute that surveyed some 30 or 40 different military engagements over the past 70 years, just in that broad region from Pakistan to Turkey to North Africa. Many of our actions around the world have been very successful, containing the North Koreans in Korea, the Cuban Missile Crisis, getting the Russians out of Afghanistan in the 1980s, the air resupply of Israel in the Yom Kippur War, and weeks later, the worldwide nuclear alert that stopped the Russians from intervening in that conflict. So we've had many successes, but well, that's the good news. The bad news, particularly for you, because you're the premier ground fighting force, along with our Marines in the U.S., we haven't done all that well in committing large numbers of ground combat troops. We need to look into this from several standpoints to try to figure out what works and what doesn't. Let me give you an example of what does work. I spend a lot of time these days talking about, in a somewhat controversial conflicted way, civil-military relations, somewhat defensively as I'm a civilian, and national strategy making around the country, here, elsewhere, with the military, with civilian audiences. I'm pretty sure, though, that from, say, 1991 to at least mid-1993, that wasn't a major theme at this August institution elsewhere, because people didn't have a concern about this. We had just finished the Gulf War. Let's take a look at that, because that certainly was the one victory, clear cut, of the six conflicts we were in. It's not just that the US military performed brilliantly, all of the services. It's that the other elements of national power were out there in the fight too. The State Department getting a set of UN resolutions, building up an alliance of almost 80 countries, working to get countries to contribute funding. Treasury was doing the same thing on funding, while also dealing with some of the ramifications of this major assault to the international financial system with the fallout of Iraq and Kuwait. The Department of Energy dealing with almost 10% of internationally traded oil, that from Kuwait and Iraq, taken off the market. The CIA figuring out not only where the forces were along with the military intelligence, but the diplomatic situation around the world. Our State Department, again, working with Israel to ensure that it wouldn't intervene in a way in that conflict that could have made things go the other way. All led by the National Security Council and the President, choosing war goals that were attainable, finding the resources, winning the support from the American people, the Congress, and the international community. That's an example of everything working right. Now, my question to you is, just to ponder, is it because those people were so much better than those of us who've been doing this for the last 10, 15 years, smarter, more competent? Or is it because the right mission was chosen and the military and the civilian agencies were given missions that they knew how to do, had trained to do, and had experience doing? So let me leave that to the side for the moment. And let's start, as always, with the basics. And the two basics are, what world are we in, and what are our values and ideals? Once again, I'm cribbing from what I've learned about what you've learned here in your strategic framework for the latter. The world we're in, and we talked a little bit about this with the people in my seminar group, Seminar 7, which I think is the best seminar group, right? Yes. Okay, thank you, Seminar 7. And also the general this morning. We're in a pretty difficult world. Michael Mandelbaum, who wrote a fascinating book called Mission Failure, puts us in the fifth phase of American foreign policy. The first was essentially where we were for the first 100 plus years, more the object than the actor in foreign policy. Then, as we emerged as A, and then the greatest world power, the first half of the 20th century. The third phase was our conflict with peer ideological threats to our very system, both existentially but also ideologically, World War II and then the Cold War. The fourth phase, and that's where it's interesting, is this phase that we associate with Michael Mandelbaum, the end of history, democracy triumphant. We were the unique international power, and we did a lot and tried to do even more. We're now in a fifth phase. People from Mandelbaum to Russell Mead have emphasized that given the near peers, a resurgent Russia and a China truly advancing in every sphere, remaining threats from phase four, North Korea and Iran and Islamic extremism, we're faced with a series of very, very serious strategic problems. At the same time, since about 2008, our own system doesn't look as permanent or as nifty as it appeared after 1989. Economically, other than America, to some degree, the rest of the West has not really recovered from 2008. And the psychological blow that that gave to the idea that people in our system of government and our system of economy would constantly get more prosperous, has left deep scars. Even our democratic institutions, as we see in places like Poland and Hungary, Brexit in England, the inability of the EU to deal with the euro crisis and then the refugee crisis. These are all very worrisome in terms of us mobilizing our world to deal with these near-peer competitors and the other challenges we have. Now, that's bad enough. But the problem we have, be it in the military or be it in the civilian sector, is that we really haven't gotten our minds around whether we have a fifth phase of our foreign policy, whether we're still locked into that happy time of phase four. I can cite a number of comments by President Obama, including very eloquent language in his UN speech in September, that indicate he's fully aware of the threats of this new phase. But I can also cite, including his State of the Union speech, very different approach, arguing that everything is hunky-dory. And that's reflected in much other thinking, inside and outside the military. I don't want to get polemical, and I probably will here, but under the kinds of near-peer challenges we have with the sort of area denial threats that the general talked about this morning and how we have to deal with it, the debate about whether we should keep 400 A-10s at the cost of possibly that many F-35s, to me, is nonsensical. We could lose a war if we don't have enough F-35s. I don't think anybody would argue we'll lose a war because we are using some other platform rather than A-10s. These are the kind of hard decisions we have to make in this period where we don't have enough resources and we got threats coming at us from all directions. It's hard servicing the targets. So the second element is our values and interests. Now, most civilians, including in the government, don't really realize this, but you folks do because the military has to adapt to it. We actually do have a national security strategy. The president issues it every few years. One went out in 2010, the last one in 2015. And it's mainly a laundry list of everything the government is doing, important or unimportant, like most of these things. But interestingly, it does emphasize what our core values are. And of significance, the same set were repeated twice, 2010, 2015, which means at least Barack Obama thinks they're important, and they are. Let me read them. As our core national goals, the security of the United States, its citizens, and U.S. allies and partners, a strong, innovative, and growing U.S. economy, and an open international economic system that promotes opportunity and prosperity, respect for universal values at home and around the world, and a rules-based international order managed by U.S. leadership. The important thing about these goals is that they reflect our tradition going back certainly since World War II and probably in some respects in terms of maintaining a friendly world order to Wilson in World War I and the rationale for going into World War I. So these are not things that some speechwriter threw together in the middle of the night in the West Wing. These are important things. And in my own experience in government, people in doubt fall back on these. These values are real. We send people into combat for these things. We spend money for these things. We motivate our foreign policy and organize ourselves on the basis of these things. And they don't differ all that much. It's basically economic, security, and political values in an international system. But notice, in every case, it's for we, the American people, and it's for the international community, or at least our, as we say, allies and partners. Well, the allies and partners add up to about two-thirds of humanity. So it's a pretty ambitious agenda. Here's the problem with it. It's very, very hard to carry out because there's a seed of controversy in this thing, both contradiction and controversy, that I'll get into in a little bit later. That can be summed up in a phrase of Henry Kissinger's, which he was using to describe Iran, but to some degree, it describes us. Is this country or a cause? We're both. Being a cause of an international order along Wilsonian lines, rule of law, collective security, free markets, free navigation, this sort of thing, is compatible with sovereignty and countries. taking it upon ourselves to promote our values of democracy, liberty, market economies inside countries starts pushing us in the cause category and conflicting with international law and our responsibilities as a member of a laws-based international system. We've never really shaken this controversy. Now, some might say, well, just dump this internal stuff. And having spent a lot of my career in the Foreign Service doing just that, not with much success, I have some sympathy. But there's a reason that that's in there, because what we discovered in World War II was that, or actually in the 1930s, an international order along Wilsonian lines, basically a liberal order, doesn't work if the members of that order are themselves internally illiberal, because by their very nature, they're going to try to destroy that order, which is alien to their interests and alien to their worldview. So that's a major problem with our ideals and values. The final problem that we have to look at today is there's a lot of ambiguity in the American people about how important these things are. This reached its peak in 2012, shown by surveys by Pew and the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, which on at least international relations are the two best survey institutions in the country. And the highest levels ever of American public concern about over-engagement abroad. That has changed somewhat in the last 4 years since then, in part because of ISIS, in part because of other developments, this fifth phase that we're in, Americans sense that it's a more dangerous world. But still, it's out there. And I give you this presidential campaign. Two of the three leading candidates in this race, in the primaries phase, to the extent we knew what their foreign policy would be, were suggesting that it would be quite different than what it has been traditionally. So we have some work to do at home if we're to keep up with this. Now, for the moment, I want to assume, because I think I'm right, that regardless of what happens in November, we will continue on with some version of what we've been doing for the last 70 to 100 years. And we're still, as the most powerful and important country in the world, with a huge stake in the international order, going to be trying to uphold it, perhaps with other means. But those means are going to include the military, thus they're going to include creating strategy, figuring out how we deal, not just with the world as a whole, at the highest level, but specific threats like Iranian nukes, the Cuban Missile Crisis, North Korea, Russia, and Eastern Europe. So how do we go about doing this? Here, Clausewitz doesn't help us that much. He emphasizes, and I know you've had all the classes, repeatedly and in different ways, the primacy of the political or the policy in the political leader, in the triad of interests, in the famous definition of war. But he doesn't help us too much on how those political leaders determine what the political goals are. His focus is on the other means, war, and how war is used to achieve, or the military is used to achieve those goals, whatever they may be. But he accepts the goals pretty much as given, as long as the military means and the political ends are consistent. But what those political ends are to be, or are, and how to get them, he's not very helpful. That's understandable, because in his world, look at the examples he had. Napoleon, against who he fought, Tsar Alexander, for whom he served, and, in the mind of every German officer, Frederick the Great in the century before, the Prussian king. These were leaders who really understood geopolitics, who understood the military, and who were able to use all elements of power extremely effectively. We don't have that in this world today. The responsibility for deciding this resides unquestionably by the Constitution, by our practice with the president. But how the president does this and the power that the president has over this is often limited. Again, I'll get into this in a second. Secondly, the process doesn't really exist. Academically, there are studies of how national security policymaking could happen, should happen, has happened. But there are no templates or other things. There's nothing like what you heard today. and what you have studied and what you've been exposed to as you were junior officers. Troop leading steps is what they called it in my day at Fort Benning. I don't know what they call it today. Do they still call it troop leading steps? Okay, that's encouraging. As I found out from the good colonel that we don't call a blouse anymore. But so there's still troop leading steps. This kind of discreet, deliberate decision-making TTPs, if you will, or SOPs, don't exist at the highest levels of government. They're vaguely aware of principles that would resemble to you, depending upon who you're talking to at which time, the principles of war, ideas like you should have an objective, you should mass most of your resources towards that objective, economize on other things, avoid surprises, protect yourself. They have this idea, but it's not in any kind of organized, coherent way. I often thought maybe I should propose that the National Security Council adopt the principles of war, but I would have been laughed out of the place. There is no coherent way to deal with problems. Let me give you an example that is actually good news, but it illustrates the problem. Back in 2007, we had a very serious, potentially war and peace situation with a Syrian nuclear reactor that they basically bought lock, stock, and barrel from the North Koreans and hid in plain sight out in the desert. It was almost ready to go critical. The Israelis were threatening to hit it. We had to deal with it. Unlike most foreign policy problems, think Vietnam, think Iraq, this was relatively discreet, so it was kind of fun to deal with. And it was one of my first jobs, one of my last jobs in the State Department, and my first jobs in the National Security Council. Well, one day, we were all summoned to the Oval Office, and President Bush, looking quite happy, got up and started waving a piece of paper and said, look, here's my ideas on Al-Kabar. Well, this is not usual. Presidents usually listen to us and then kind of find ways to signal vaguely what they might want. But he had a plan, a way to go forward. And the thing was all numbers and boxes and lines. It looked like one of Perkins's charts. And people looked aghast at this thing, turning it upside down and then upside down, forwards again. And I think they were afraid that we were going to have to invade Iraq again. But finally it got to me, and as you'd heard from the intro, I've got a master's in business administration, as does President Bush, from Harvard, no less. What he had done is a standard decision tree, taking the options, weighing them in terms of risk, value, and cost, and coming up with a perfectly serviceable way forward, which is what we did, or what we proposed. Eventually, we came to a different solution with the Israelis, but this was our policy for several months. And I'm citing this to say, A, this is the only example I've ever seen, and B, nobody understood what the hell he was doing. Okay, a final example. I made my mark in the National Security Council because after a few months, I came to my boss, Steve Hadley, and said, Steve, we have no idea what the president is doing. Now, what decisions he's taking and whether we should be following up on them. Now, you've learned all about the National Security Council, and if you expect me to talk about the various meetings at various levels with various groups, I'm not going to do that. It's, first of all, not important, and secondly, you've had it. But those things produce things called SOCs, Statement of Conclusions, which do elaborate in great detail what was actually agreed at these meetings, or at least what the National Security Council staff is like me thought was agreed at these meetings. But most of the decisions taken by a president or anybody are going to be in informal conversations, calls with foreign leaders, meetings in the Oval Office and such. We had no idea. So I came up with a highly technical idea put on our server. Date, presidential decision, responsible office, deadline, or action to be done. And people thought this was brilliant. I mean, my wife has a more sophisticated inventory of my commitments to her than we had on the President of the United States. But the thing actually worked, and as I said, it was like a revolution. This is the level we're dealing with at the highest levels in government. Now, in case you think that essentially this is like the kiddies have taken over the camp and that presidents and National Security Council staffs and that sort of thing have no idea of what's going on, it's true that they don't have formal ways of getting to decisions, but they often do. before you depart with the idea of, gosh, do we really want decisions made by these people? Think of FDR in 1942. With limited military experience, he was the number two in the Department of Navy in World War I. He figured out that launching a ground offensive into Western Europe in 1942 would be suicidal for the British and us. Yet our top generals, men we, for good reason, revere, Marshall, Eisenhower, were all for it. It was really hard for Roosevelt to beat these guys down. These are guys who don't take no for an answer. But he finally just barely did. And then a few weeks later, Dieppe happened. Are there any Canadian officers here? Are there British officers here? I know. And they can tell you what happened in Dieppe, or you've probably studied it. Thank goodness he prevailed. So you do have somehow, some way, gut instinct, it sort of works. But it is a very messy process. I don't know how much this helps you. Let me very quickly go through six areas where national security, civilian military issues get wrapped up around the axle. Then we'll summarize and we'll go to questions. First of all is the Constitution. Our Constitution was written by people for whom the last thing they wanted was a Napoleon or a Frederick the Great or a Tsar Alexander. They wanted an ineffective executive under the control of the states, of the Congress, and of the American people. They wanted one that would have a hard time taking decisions, not an easy time. And to some degree, they got their wish. So we've had presidents, two of them, Truman and Johnson, that launched us into wars. The wars didn't work well. And they basically had to decide that they wouldn't run again for office. When our back is really to the wall, and when we're lucky, and when that's happened twice, when those two events came together, unfortunately the two came together, Lincoln in the Civil War and FDR in World War II, we're able to surmount these congressional challenges, these congressional limitations on our ability to take decisions. But believe me, these are real, they're very difficult, and much of the time spent in the White House at the top levels of all of the foreign policy-oriented agencies is dealing with them. Okay, next, the nature of governance, how the political leadership sees itself governing the country. Now, you might think, okay, they got the military over here, a couple of million people counting reserves and civilians, and then you got a couple of million more civilians doing all those other agencies' work. That's a huge managerial task, and that's what they do all day. No, they don't. As you know, you basically run yourself with some help from Congress. As those people from the civilian side of the U.S. government who are here today can tell you, it's much more the case with the civilian bureaucracies. The department of this, the department of that. It's congressional committees that oversee them, congressional staffers, lobbyists, lawyers, budgeteers, and to some degree, the top leadership who determine the running of our government. Only when something goes critical, Katrina, the Veterans Administration, the rollout of Obamacare, does the top levels of government focus on what you would consider normal management or administration. Basically, running the government at the presidential level, policy making, policy execution, is in the political sphere. It resembles what they have grown up with and what they know how to do, which is campaign, reach out to the American public, convince people of things. This is a different kind of thinking. This is thinking like psychiatrists, religious leaders, ideologues, your spouse or lover deals with. This is all about trust, and it's all about feelings, and it's all about whether we can move together and so forth. It's not very concrete. But that's the world that political people live in. Thus, the rhetoric is overblown. A war on poverty, a war on drugs. You saw at the last State of the Union, President Obama turns to Joe Biden and says, you're going to eliminate cancer. Biden says, oh, okay. Now, you can't do troops to task on this kind of thinking, on this kind of policy making, but it is hardwired into the system. It's hard for them to get out of this, and I'll explain why in a second. And That involves the third element. They don't know how to use the military. The military, while it has emotional and trust elements, as we saw from the slide that General Perkins so eloquently talked about, and involves life and death. So there's an emotional and sort of gravitas and pathos with the military that the civilian side of life doesn't usually cover. But by and large, it's also very scientific. It's very fast-moving and real. Scientific, dealing in the world of facts, not in the world of dreams and hopes and ideas and ideologies. And it's win or lose. It's up or down. It's like the business world. If you're in the red for long enough, you're finished. You got to be in the black. In the military, you win or you lose. Results are what counts, not inputs. This is very different in the political realm. In that realm, rhetoric up here and down here, you've got inputs. Inputs are important. First of all, they're very hard to come up with because that requires going to another branch of Congress, usually, and getting the money. So a lot of emphasis is put on inputs. But also, presidents and political leaders want to emphasize how much they care about a problem and what they're throwing at the problem. And the fact that we may have doubled the number of people focused on Zika will be a talking point put out around the world. Now, that might have gone from 8 to 16 people. It doesn't matter. It's all about getting the word out, the spin. And I'm not trying to denigrate that. That's the only way you can run a democratic system. But when you then try to apply that to the military, you've got a problem. Again, because the military, it's up or down. It doesn't matter how hard you try. It doesn't matter how many bombs you drop or how many airstrikes you do or, as we learned in Vietnam, how many people we kill. What matters is, do results that we need achieved get achieved? If not, you lose. It's that simple. And this clash of those two cultures constantly makes things worse. It leads to, in particular, incrementalism. We add troop elements by the teens or the dozens or the hundreds. And you've all experienced this, and we've experienced it in Vietnam, we've experienced it in war after war, without any idea of, well, is that going to receive the result we want, which is a certain state, defeat ISIS, for example, or is that going to show, hey, get off our back that we haven't defeated ISIS in 2 years. We've just increased the number of special forces teams by 60%. That's the political response to things. Now, again, there's a reason for this, because politicians have learned that to do things, to accomplish things, to achieve things, particularly against resistance, think of sports, think of the military, think of competitive business, is really hard, takes a lot of resources, usually a fair amount of time, and a lot of command emphasis at the top. And you can't do 60 different things to please 60 different constituencies if you're focusing on one thing. Any president knows this. In the case of President Bush, it was winning in Iraq, and he eventually succeeded, kind of, with the surge. In the case of President Obama, it was Obamacare, and it was the Iran negotiations. He did focus on those. But the other 60 things, they didn't just leave. They gave lip service to it, and they figured that that would be enough. They didn't want to take the risks of rolling the dice on something that wasn't ultra important. And that's how they'll deal with security issues, military issues, and diplomatic issues as well. Normally, unless somebody rears up and says, stop. Okay, those are three problems. Fourth problem, the civilian bureaucracy. How many times have you heard, I've certainly heard it enough, and gosh knows what you say among yourselves, why doesn't somebody do a Goldwater Nichols on those civilian agencies, the rest of the interagency, so that they can stand up and do their share in the fight against this or that or the other thing? It's as if we could become the sixth service sort of next to but slightly below and less glorious than the Coast Guard. Yeah, you laugh, but you know you've thought that way. You've heard other people thinking that way. Right. Yeah, okay. It ain't going to happen. We're not the military. We're never going to be the military. The attitude of the American people, for good reason, to the military, the adoration of it under most circumstances, is based upon very real differences. You control, depending on the year, 3 to 6% of GDP, and you have a huge say in how it will be spent. And you have one committee in each house that manages you. These civilian agencies, they're controlled by all kinds of committees and subcommittees and other elements of Congress that maintain a hostile attitude towards them. The last thing they want is TSA agents who are in great supply or great demand with the long lines going off to teach people in other countries how to do security at their airports, even if that could impact us. Or send people from Justice and Treasury out to reinforce embassies in places like Iraq and Afghanistan. This is extremely high because that's not what the Congress and the American people created these institutions for. So you have, even in the foreign affairs agencies, with the exception of CIA, which is basically a paramilitary agency, you have a real problem in getting those agencies to mesh with you the way, in the best of all possible worlds, they should. Even then, that won't change a lot, but that I'll get to in a second. The next problem is with the military. No matter how often the military learns and pays homage to the Clausewitzian primacy of politics, continuation of policy by other means, and that sort of thing, there is still a nagging feeling that the military generates, because it's really there, that the military really should decide what winning is. And a little bit of this was discussed by General Perkins, the idea of winning the fight. Winning the fight isn't the most important thing. This became a dramatic issue in 1950, 1951 with General MacArthur. And you remember his last words, I think at West Point or on his deathbed, there's no substitute for victory. Well, his definition of victory was very different than Harry Truman's. Harry Truman got his victory, which was to keep South Korea from being overrun by North Korea. MacArthur had a very different definition of victory. Whose was right? There's no question. The president gets to decide, not a general. We've moved to some degree away from this very victory equals surrender on the Missouri concept. But it is very, very important to understand that however badly the political system works in coming up with decisions, and I've spent some time describing how bad it works, those decisions are what counts. They decide what you will do or not do. And this has continued on into this area, and it's understandable. You have to tell young soldiers to risk their lives, perhaps lose them, and to take others' lives. It has to mean something. That's who we are as people. And thus, you're looking for goals that justify the effort and cost and sacrifice. And I understand that. I've been there. But nonetheless, that doesn't take away the primacy of politics. How many times I've heard, yeah, we got to do this job right, or we're going to just be back there again. I bet many of you have heard that as well. Well, let me tell you, if politics decide we're just going to have to go back there, so be it. No less an entity used to and good at, skilled at, political military decision making, Israel, has decided that, yeah, going in and, as they say, mowing the lawn occasionally in Gaza and in southern Lebanon when necessary is better than either ignoring the problem and letting these people keep hitting you or going in a major war with major international repercussions. Those are important lessons. The political primacy is really important, and that's hard for military people from my own exposure, both being a military person and then observing it closely for the 35 years in the Foreign Service and time afterwards. The final problem is, and this gets back to the cause in a country, the mission we give ourselves of fixing other countries to look like us, or as Michael Mandelbaum says in his book, On the Road to Denmark, is a mission impossible. Even if we get a better interagency, even if we can fix a lot of these phase four and counterinsurgency coordination problems and all of that, and we should, because these are important and good rules of the road. When we're dealing with a competent local partner, we need to know how to do counterinsurgency. We need to know how to do at least on the margins nation building or building the critical elements that will keep a nation together. There's nothing wrong with that. What's wrong is to think it's primarily our job. Because if we do this, A, other than in a few special cases, Germany and Japan notably, we really haven't been successful, and the odds against us are great. Some of the people that we're trying to do this, for good or bad reasons, some of them just think that we're trying to colonialize them, they don't believe us, will resist violently. And that means a long extended insurgency. Neighbors, be it in Korea, 1950, be it in Vietnam in the 1960s, be it in Afghanistan and Iraq, what do? They decide they don't want America to get a win next door, so they do everything they can to make life miserable for us, and they can do a lot. So this is a recipe for a long, drawn-out, bloody conflict that everybody forgets. Tell me again why we're doing this. And one day, the American public wakes up, and they vote out a president or threaten to vote him out, as in 68, or they hand the Congress to the other party, as they did in 2006. So in looking at these political military problems, we have to be aware that you not only need clarity in your goals, but even if there's clarity, even if the president knows where he or she wants to go, it has to be a sustainable policy. And to some degree, the military, at least at the highest levels, has to act as a sort of, not check, but a team B to look at, is this going to be sustained not only by the president but by the country? And boy, that's a very tough and, at the margins, almost heretical point. So I'll stop there and open up for questions. Thank you very much. Okay, back there.
Lieutenant Colonel Tim Coakley, Seminar 14. Can you propose some of the potential causes of the recent coup attempt in Turkey and the effect on U.S.-Turkish relations?
I would normally say I don't think it was the Gulenist movement, but my exposure to and experience with the Gulenist movement in particular and Islamic movements in general is you never know how far they infiltrate one or another element of a society. I wouldn't rule out that they didn't have a role in infiltrating parts of the military. Notice it was only parts of the military. This was not a Turkish military coup like we used to Turkish military coups. Turkish military coups are really competent. They know how to do this. They've had practice at it over the past. And they're very good at it, and I mean this in a very smart way. I once wrote a paper saying General Sisi should learn from General Evren in 1980 because they turned the country back to democratic forces. Possibly the Gulenist movement, possibly a group of people in the military who just hate President Erdogan in his alternative universe view of Turkey, of culture, of Islam, and everything else. Turkey, in many respects, is a divided country. At his best, Erdogan gets 50% of the vote. At his worst, in June of last year, for example, 40%. And the more it's about him and his values, which was the June election, he only gets 40%. So a lot of people are very concerned that he's taking the entire country in a direction that only a plurality of people, or not even a plurality, a minority, albeit a large minority, want. So those are the probable reasons. What's going to happen next? Relations with the U.S. are a subset of the fork in the road before President Erdogan. He now has, because of the nature of the coup and how he responded to it, how effectively he put it down, because believe me, he did a great job, he can either take this country down the road to essentially a quasi-democratic, totally authoritarian state, possibly with far more Islamic elements than we thought he would be interested in, or he can try to return to the period of his first two terms where he reached out to people across the entire spectrum, because people across the entire spectrum supported the government, even if not him, against the military last weekend. And I can't tell, and I know him pretty well, I can't tell which way he's going to go. I have my suspicions, but I would say there's enough of a chance that he'll take either road for me to leave the question open. Relations with the U.S. will hinge largely on which way he goes. If he goes that second road back towards his first two terms, a return to the very good relations we had in that era, not coincidentally, like every ambassador, relations were great when I was there. It was the fellows before me or after me who screwed it up. Anyway, that's a possibility. If he goes down the other road, there are two dangers. Danger number one is we're simply not going to be able to stomach however realpolitik we want to be and however important Turkey is to our geostrategic interests, and it's hugely important, what he might be doing to the country, because aside from violating our values, practically he's going to make the country ungovernable and he's going to make the country economically not viable as a modern state. And that will hurt its ability to play its role as a partner. Secondly, he has in the past, as have other Turkish leaders, this is common, lashed out at us as a way of mobilizing support. This is common not only to Turkey, but Turkey has worked it to a science. So we're used to that. In fact, I just did a piece where I said we need to shrug most of this verbal abuse off because it happens all of the time. Don't take it seriously. But if he decides to take it seriously with real impact on our actions in the region against the many threats we have there, then I would see a very, very serious deterioration of relations. And it's very hard to imagine what we do, with whom, under which conditions, in NATO or the Middle East without Turkey. So hope for the him going the right way. Please, next question. Please, you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Ambassador. Rob Pelucci, Seminar 15. A lot of people point to the U.S. withdrawal from Iraq back in 2011 as the, you know, sort of the catalyst that set forth, you know, ISIS's rise today. Take us back to 2011, December, 50,000 troops on the ground, 16,000 employees within your ambassadorship in the embassy, $6 billion a year. The first question is, did the president offer Malachi an offer he just could not accept ever? And just how close were you to achieving that deal? And then thirdly, what difference would that have made today?
Good grief. How much time do I have? Okay. All right. And I'll try to be as objective as possible. But remember the rule I told you about ambassadors and relations during their tenure always being hunky-dory. This wasn't so hunky-dory. But I have to start not in late 2011, but late 2008. The decision to withdraw American troops from Iraq was taken by President Bush and sealed in the Status of Forces Agreement, which was, that's what we call it, the 2008 Status of Forces Agreement. Anybody know what the official Iraqi name of it is? Document covering the withdrawal of the American forces from Iraq, because that's what it was. And that was the price we paid for three more years and for getting a Status of Forces Agreement through the parliament, which we felt was absolutely necessary if this was going to be a democratic rule of law state. For reason, any lawyers, yeah, there are lawyers here, I know. But for reasons that the lawyers all know, presidents or prime ministers cannot waive fundamental laws for foreigners without the parliaments approving them, because the parliaments make the laws. I mean, it's very basic. And there's, to the extent you ever get agreement on anything, we got agreement on this. In 2008, I was involved in it then in the White House, and then in 2011. So 2010 comes around, and General Austin goes out, and I go out as ambassador, and we look around and say, we don't like the idea of pulling all the troops out. That can lead to all kinds of problems, most of which came to pass. It isn't that we were prescient. I mean, it's Iraq, it's the Middle East. Come on, we were experienced. We knew what would happen. Not exactly who would happen. We didn't figure Syria. I mean, who could have guessed Syria? But we knew something bad was going to happen. Let's keep an insurance policy and keep troops on. We went to the president, and in January of, or the 1st of February of 2011, he said yes. Then the bureaucracy churned itself in knots for 6 months trying to figure out how many troops. That's a whole other story, but I'll leave it to one side. And that could have been a little bit more decisive presidential leadership saying, the number's X, stop spatting, that's what I want to support. But we went back and forth on numbers, and it was really agonizing. And then finally, we kind of came to a number, 10,000, which we then, of course, reduced to 5,000. And we went to Maliki in June. Maliki knew we were going to do this. He half wanted us to do it, but he knew that there was Iranian pressure and there was tremendous pressure from the parliament. He said, don't go to the parliament. I can't get you another Status of Forces Agreement voted through the parliament. And the reason was, think where Iraq was in 2008. It had just had two near-death experiences. The Al-Qaeda insurgency finally put down by late 2007, early 2008, thanks to the awakening and the surge, and the uprising of Shia militias, particularly the Badr people, first in Basra and then in Sadr City. People didn't want us to go away. They didn't like us very much. The polls showed that, but they also felt they needed us. 2011, you fast forward, the country's pretty quiet. Other than occasionally shooting at us, the Shia militias were quiescent and were kind of working their way into the political system, in fact. And Al-Qaeda was basically a quasi-criminal gang, quasi-terrorist organization operating mainly out of Mosul. So there was no real perceived need for us, and the polls were terrible. They were in the teens countrywide, and that was only because half the Kurds said they wanted us to stay on. So we didn't have popular support. But despite that, Maliki said, look, I can do this if I sign a paper. Bear in mind, that's exactly the basis upon which we're operating there now, but I'll come to that in a second. So we went back to Washington, and my recommendation, and I think of everybody else with one exception, to the cabinet level, and by all the lawyers who were working as lawyers, was the paper isn't worth, the status of force agreement isn't worth the paper it is printed on in a truly democratic country, and that's the whole purpose of our being there, isn't it? Rule of law, democracy, if the parliament doesn't approve it. It won't stand up in an Iraqi court. So we decided we had to get it. We pushed the Iraqis. The Iraqis, after, as I said, much Washington shooting itself in the foot for month after month, we finally got them a package. They very quickly organized three meetings of all the parties. All the parties, except obviously the Sadrists, wanted us to stay. But only the Kurds, not the Sunni party, Iraqiya, was willing to take it to a vote in the parliament. The rest said, you can stay, but not with the status of force agreement approved by the parliament. Let Maliki give you a piece of paper and stay on the basis. And on that basis, the president felt, and he was supported by all of us, that we couldn't keep troops on. Now you might say, but wait, the president reversed himself. I support his reversal because in 2014, we were facing, and the Iraqis were facing, a dramatic security situation. ISIS had seized a third of the country. They were advancing on Baghdad. They were a clear and present danger to Iraq, and they were a clear and present danger to us. I know that in your strategic framework, what is the last of the many elements you look at? What? Risk, right. The risk of the Sadrists having some judge grab our soldiers and not yield him or her was very great in 2011. The chances of that happening in this period, when there's a clear and present danger from ISIS, is relatively low. Secondly, the importance to the American people of fighting ISIS is very high. The importance to the American people of keeping troops on in Iraq in 2011 was minimal. Inside the beltway, as we say, among us experts, we said, yeah, we better do this or we're going to regret it. But that's not how the American people felt. They were happy for us to come home. It's what Obama had campaigned on. He reversed himself. Now, how much enthusiasm he put into this, people can debate. But the point is, he took our recommendation. He gave us the green light to negotiate it. And in the end, on our recommendation, he pulled the plug. Effects of it, you're damn tootin'. I can't say none of this would have happened if we had had 5,000 troops in Iraq, but aside from all the things the 5,000 troops had done, and they were gonna do all kinds of neat things, and some of which I was gonna do as an ambassador, and there's a whole other set of reasons why ambassadors can't play generalissimo. But most important thing of having troops is not the counterterrorism or intelligence or training or eyes on that they bring. It's the fact that if you've got troops downrange, you've got a Congress, an American people, a Secretary of Defense, and a chairman who really care about what's going on in that country, and they will ram things down the throat of the bureaucracy. And that's what you don't have in any situation where you don't have American boots on the ground. This is my own personal theory. I've never seen it written anyplace else, but I've lived it. Having troops on the ground focuses the minds of Washington in a way nothing else does. Okay. Now you're not, okay, here we go.
Hello, sir. My name's Joe Caput from Seminar 10. My guess is in your time in Washington, you've seen a dramatic increase in the size of the National Security Council. And I'm just wondering if you think that's healthy for military decision-making.
Nah, it's awful. It's not just the increase. It's the way it's done. And you all know the horror stories because we now have three former secretaries of defense who spend gallons of ink writing about the awful things they saw. I think it was Gates who saw, you know, an NSC staffer's speed dial on the phone of a JSOC element somewhere in Afghanistan. It's this kind of micromanaging by kiddies who get all sexed up by playing soldier and are empowered by an immature system. You know, my solution, when I was in the National Security Council, the National Security Advisor, the President, and the deputy, me, were all former officers in the military. We kind of understood the military. We sympathized with the military. And we didn't have that. Even with the small number of people we had then, we could have micromanaged a hell of a lot, but we didn't. Because Bob Gates or his deputy would have called and said, hey, stop that. This happens all the time. And because people love Steve Hadley, National Security Advisor, whether it was my fault or not, they would always call me and chew me out because I was the pincushion for the entire National Security Council. It took me a year and a half to figure out, besides coming up with that great shot, that was my real purpose, was for cabinet members to call and complain about our people. And we would beat them back. The president would call us and say, hey, I've learned that such and such is getting involved, getting ahead of the headlights, and we would pull them back in. But it takes that level of paying attention. If you empower these people and you let the cabinet members know that they're not really in charge of their own cabinets, you're going to get this. It's just that simple, and it is terrible. I cannot tell you how dysfunctional this makes things. There are basic problems, as I see it, with the philosophy behind some of the decisions this administration has taken, just like the last one. They both committed their share of errors. But there's a dysfunctionality in this one at this point is quite large. There was a real dysfunctionality in the last one in the first 3 years, but that got fixed bit by bit after Hadley came to the National Security Council, after Gates came to defense. But both administrations have had it. There is a tendency for these guys to spin out of control. I just gave you an illustrative list of all of the ways that this can get bad in my 1 through 6. But there are hundreds of other ways that this bureaucracy can be bad, not good for America. Yeah.
Thank you, Ambassador. Colonel Kip Lastner, Seminar 20. Can you give us your candid assessment of what caused the breakdown in civil-military relations in Iraq in 2003 between the strategic military leadership and the mission versus the civilian and, you know, Paul Bremer and debathification, etc.
Okay. We could talk for hours on personalities and specific decisions. The basic problem is, this goes to the very core of the decision to go into Iraq. Among the people who supported that, remember, people from the outside looking in see kind of Colin Powell, elements of the intelligence community, every third day, maybe a little bit Condoleezza Rice, as cautious about going into Iraq, and everybody else, led by Rumsfeld and Cheney, pressing the president. So there were two camps, supposedly. Not really, there were three camps. The least important was the camp around Powell, because the president had decided early on, at least by the beginning of 2002, to do Iraq. But the question was the motivation. The do Iraq camp agreed that we had to go in and take this guy and that state out. That state, that army, that government had to go away. The reasons for that, though, differed. To one or another degree, and a lot of this, even though I was there to witness a lot of this and I read almost everything published, is my own theory, I can't claim it for sure, is to one or another degree, Secretary Rumsfeld and Vice President Cheney felt that America needed to deter potential foes and reassure allies by showing that you don't kick us in the face like 9/11. And our only response is to, you know, sort of bungle in, where was it, the Korabora Mountains or wherever, Torabora, without getting Saddam Hussein. That we had to show the world that you don't mess with us. And the best way to do that was Saddam, who'd been messing with us back since 1990, and who they really did believe, please don't get me wrong, they really thought that he had weapons of mass destruction programs. There's no doubt about that. The second group, Paul Wolfowitz, most days, National Security Advisor Rice, and certainly the president and certain other advisors, believed that the Middle East and 9/11 were symptoms of an underlying rot, and that this rot was rather like Eastern Europe in the 1970s and 80s. And the way to liberate that region and thus protect us from new 9/11s wasn't to kick tail with Saddam's army as an end, but rather, if necessary, as a means to inject democracy and liberal values into the region. They thought that the populations were thirsting, were lusting for it like the populations of Eastern Europe. One of my peculiarities is I'm one of the few people who's had a lot of experience in Europe, particularly Eastern and Southeastern Europe, and a lot of experience in the Middle East. I was the political advisor to Radio Free Europe when the wall came down. I had served in Eastern Europe, in Bulgaria, and I knew this is like night and day. The Bulgarians dream of being like you. I never met anybody in the Middle East, even in the relatively secular state of Turkey before Erdogan, that really wanted to be like you. And we were trying to undertake a strategy to clear out the political leadership and open the door to the people realizing their ambition of being like us, recognizing Israel, bringing in the oil firms, entrepreneurial activities, and all of this. As Michael Mandelbaum says, on the road to Denmark. Actually, Denmark's too socialistic. On the road to Texas. Even oil rigs. Okay. Yeah, Texas is better than Denmark. Anyway, so, and that was the division, because the military was under the day in, day out control of Don Rumsfeld, and he didn't want to hear about counterinsurgency. The civilian side, more influenced by the president, was trying to get a process going, but the main challenge to it was the insurgency, so it needed a counterinsurgency. It needed the military to commit to stay and fight the insurgency. The most Rumsfeld would agree with, and this was back and forth at the very highest levels of government. I mean, I watched this for years, and you could just see the ship sinking. The most that DOD would agree to was keep the military on to train the Iraqis to do counterinsurgency. Well, the Iraqis suck at counterinsurgency, as we saw in 2014. And we're very good at it, as I saw in Vietnam in 1972, when we put our minds to it, but we didn't put our minds to it. So that was, aside from all the personalities and all the specifics, and you know, there are hundreds of thousands of pages on those, the basic problem was the president did not decide until 2006 whether we were really in an insurgency, and in 2006, at the end of it, January 2007, he put together a team, Petraeus, Crocker, Gates, the new edition of Rice at State, who were willing to do that in a consistent, all elements of power way, and you saw how quickly, how much improved. So it's a happy ending, at least a temporary happy ending. Okay, yeah, back there.
Lieutenant Colonel Padron, Seminar 12. Ambassador Jeffries, I'd like to hear your perspective on something that we've witnessed as students here during these last 2 years at the War College, and turn your head a little bit towards our own hemisphere here, and hear your perspective as an ambassador as to how you see the new relations with Cuba working out.
Next question.
That's very Perkins of you. Thank you.
Okay. That's an excellent question. I'm going to slide on that. Now, I promised I wouldn't make fun of...
That's a great slide, too.
I said I wouldn't make fun of Perkins. Come on. Okay. Now, I left it in the other room. Okay, I'll give you my unvarnished version. Eyewash. The president truly believes... President is conflicted on this. I mean, both my personal interactions with him, and I've studiously, it's what I do for a living now, follow his statements and his actions. And he's conflicted between the Obama of Oslo in 2009 when he got the Peace Prize, when he went on and on, shocking the Europeans, much to my delight, about how basically they were alive and healthy because of 7 decades of America, not just with words, but with the might of our armed forces and the blood of our citizens preserving liberty. Wow, great language. At other times, he sounds like what I was hearing in the 60s from Eugene McCarthy and McGovern. I think he's conflicted. I think he sees both. Cuba is a manifestation of his belief that just maybe part of the reason we have problems in the world, we have near-peer competitors, we have problems, is that we make things more difficult by pushing people into hostile relations. He saw that with Cuba. Fortunately, he doesn't see this with China, which is why he put two aircraft carriers in the South China Sea recently. There's nothing wrong in a realpolitik way with his relationship with China, and I really care about that. I don't care about Cuba. I think he's wrong. I think it's one-sided. We didn't negotiate anything. They didn't agree to end any of their obnoxious and evil policies. They just had a photo op, and nothing will come of this. Nothing good, but almost nothing bad, because where it's really important, now the president's got 6 months to take some decisions, and I'm really worried about the no first use decision, but so far he has done nothing to harm our security. And in most of the issues other than Syria, I think he's done the right thing. Cuba is a wrong thing, but it's a minor thing. How's that? Next question, thank you.
Moshe Schwartz from Seminar 20, perhaps I can ask an easier question. Where do you see the Middle East in about 10 years?
I just hope I'm not dragged back at 80 on one of our last outposts. Here's my optimistic scenario. Much of what we see wrong in the Middle East is a function of demographic developments that will change for the better as this huge bulge of young, underemployed, angry, no significant other sex key leader engagements, as you would call it, in their lives, work their way through the system. So in that sense, I'm more optimistic. The reason that I'm tempering this is I don't know to what extent the problems with global warming will impact that region, because it'll impact that region more than any other. And that could get serious in terms of because a lot of crops are grown in the Middle East. They are an agricultural area. And if there's a lot of problems with that, you will have more, and much of their society is based upon at least rural traditions, and you know, your great-grandmother is still out there on the farm or with the goats and such. So I think we should worry a lot about where the Middle East is going to be in 10 years. A lot depends on... The Middle East is pretty resilient. Look at Iraq. Look what's happened to Iraq. Oil prices have dropped 50%, and ISIS takes over a third of the country. You know, it constitutionally replaced its third prime minister, Maliki, in 2014. It's still hanging together. And much of the Middle East is like that. Egypt is still hanging together. Look at Pakistan. In the National Security Council, every week, somebody would rush in with the slides showing that Pakistan was going to go belly up in 6 weeks because either the terrorists would take over the country, somebody bad would get the nukes, or they would run out of money to buy fuel that they had to import. And every 6 weeks, We got the same briefing again, but the country is still functioning. So it may be more resilient than we think. Let's hope so. We can make a difference, not in changing the region to be like Denmark, but to ensure that bad developments don't get really, really bad. And the best example of a bad development getting really, really bad because we took our fingers from the action was Syria. Now, we might have gotten in just as much trouble and lost more lives and more money had we gone into Syria. We'll never know at this point. But Syria is a good example of the bad gift that keeps on giving, bad blood and instability in the region. It produced ISIS, it produced the flow of refugees to Europe that is undermining the EU, and it produced the re-engagement of Russia in the Middle East, probably as an ally of Iran. Who likes this scenario? So a lot depends on whether we will avoid the worst, these problems from spilling over into a true undercutting of the nation-state system. That's what's at risk right now in the Middle East, that it will be replaced with chaos. And chaos is just going to come to our shores. Next question. Please.
Sir, Lieutenant Colonel Young, Seminar 10. What's your opinion of what the State Department and the Department of Defense should have done different in 2003 for planning and execution of post-war Iraq?
Just said no. Somebody should have said, around, January, after we'd had most of the troops on the ground, okay, Saddam, we've cut a deal with the Saudis, we've cut a deal with Idi Amin, or his successor, we've cut a deal with Switzerland, you get to go with as much gold as your plane can carry. And you turn the country over to somebody else, and you let the inspectors in, and everybody will end this thing peacefully. That's what we should have proposed. Why didn't we? Because there was this dual motivation. We have to destroy Saddam and his state to show that we can. That's one part of the leadership. And we have to destroy Saddam and his state so that, like 1989 in Eastern Europe, we can clear the way for the democratic revolution that is just bursting its seams to emerge. Here's a really important point. Had we known that people were really seriously thinking that, at least in the State Department, we would have responded much more aggressively. We really didn't know. We really thought that they were going to turn it over to Chalabi and come home. We didn't like Chalabi. We didn't think that he could do anything. But we've been working with all of these people, Chalabi, Barzani, Skiri, the Supreme Council. We knew all these guys, the al-Hakims, others of the Shia. We knew the people who would kind of take over the country. We didn't first imagine, A, that we would totally annihilate the system, which was easy to annihilate after 30 years of Saddam, 20 years of Saddam misrule. And we didn't know that that was the actual goal. Had we known that, we might have been able to do that. That gets to how the decisions were made. They were not made in a clear fashion. If Powell was fully aware of that, he could have unleashed all of this. You saw, I mean, look, on something I don't even agree with, we got 51 State Department offices to get all kinds of publicity, you know, attacking the president's Syria policy. You can't imagine what the State Department would, it would have gone totally crazy if we knew what was going on, but we didn't. So what could have been done different was, at the very top levels of government, making clear what the real goals are. What's the objective? Just what you learn every day. What is it? It's the first of the principles of war. What is the objective? The objective is to defeat Saddam, plant the flag in Baghdad. Okay, for what political end? You have to ask that question. And there would have been roar and fog when that question was asked, had it been asked. I'm not even so sure it was asked. But once you get fog and the whirring sound, you've got to dig into it because it's your soldiers and their lives that are at stake. Next question, yeah.
Sir, Kirk Daly, Seminar 14. What would you recommend? I think we have maybe a couple or a handful of State Department employees here. We probably send a handful to State Department type of seminars and whatnot. One of the things I gather from this is a lack of appreciation of the culture of some of the places where we go or at least try to. So not only with the countries, but also with the relations between state and defense, do you have any recommendations for what we could do to improve that flow of communication and organization relationships and things like that?
Yeah. Look, the military does a brilliant job training people in the culture and details of countries. The problem is, as an extremely highly centralized organization with very important and understandable priorities, force protection, accomplishing the mission the president has given, there are difficulties having that input fed into high-level military decision-making. And you saw this back and forth with rules of engagement and things like this in Iraq and Afghanistan, with commanders taking different views depending upon what they felt should be the priority. But the knowledge base is there. The military should congratulate itself on that. State, it's hard to the first point to make is it works well in the field. It works well in the field because ambassadors and combatant commanders have very specific instructions. Ambassadors get a letter from the president that tells them how to deal with a combatant commander. Combatant commanders, both by their training and background and their guidance from the Secretary of Defense also, and the fact that they have to operate in countries where there's no status of forces, immediately plug into ambassadors. Ambassadors generally are very happy with their relations with combatant commanders. Combatant commanders are not always happy with the relations with ambassadors, but give us a break. For every combatant commander, he or she's got 30 or 40 ambassadors. You know, what's the odds of they're all going to be happy cases? But most of them are, and importantly, almost always in the places that really count to the combatant commander, you will get very good people who will ensure that the military's equities, which are often the equities of the host nation, are taken care of. Where the system breaks down is in Washington, which is exactly, I'm kind of dancing around your question, but the core of it is in Washington there are a lot of problems. Part of it is both the combatant commanders and the ambassadors in various ways are quasi-independent, certainly ambassadors of the State Department. And so all kinds of deals are worked out in the field. And that's a problem, although that's a good problem because they're left to their own devices, 9 times out of 10, go with what the field comes up with rather than what the department does. While it may be inaccurate in some details, go see the movie about Benghazi, 13 hours, and see what the people in the field managed to do without anybody in Washington giving them helpful advice by tying them to the phone for hours, giving sit reps and listening to idiot ideas from everybody up to Newt Gingrich. This is a real story with me and Newt Gingrich in a crisis, okay? This is what happens if Washington can actually get to you. So the system isn't as bad as that. In Washington, there are problems. The one single discrete thing that could be done, and it is disgraceful that we haven't done it, and there are reasons for it, and there are at least as much state as defense's fault, is we need to align our geographic combatant commands with our State Department bureaus. Forget about the State Department wiring diagram. I mean, that also really looks like something more complicated than the TRADOX one. With all kinds of levels of deputies, 2 deputy secretaries, 5 or 6 undersecretaries, by and large, forget them. Talk to your State Department people here. It's a handful of third-level officials, the assistant secretaries, who rule, the one for Europe, the one for the Middle East. These are like gods in the Foreign Service. Some of them are political appointees, but they're like gods, too. They're the people who are always with the secretary whenever he or she travels to any of these regions. They're the people who go right directly to the secretary, as you can now see with the email issue. And these are the people who have the effective power, but it's discombobulated with the military because these alignments are not there. That would help an awful lot. And then probably we spend a lot of effort and money and a lot of people exchanging liaisons, but there is no rules of the role of how to use liaison officers, either military officers in the Department of State or State Department POLADs with, and there's now over 100 of them. What are they supposed to do? What are their authorities? What are the things they have to be brought in on? Nobody has come up with any rules of the role. We just generate hundreds of these people sent out there, and sometimes they get really great jobs, sometimes they're ignored. It all depends, and it shouldn't be that way. I think that's it.